Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Our today's topic is one of the most common liver disease throughout the world, the fatty liver disease, the non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. And in today's talk, we will try to cover these important aspects for this entity. The definition of this NASH, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, it is basically a clinical or pathological syndrome, and it encompasses several clinical entities, and they range from simple fat accumulation or steatosis to fat accumulation with inflammation, which is steatohepatitis, progressive fibrosis, and may end up end-stage liver disease in the absence of significant alcohol intake. This is important because there should not be significant alcohol intake to make a definition and diagnosis of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. And NASH is a part of spectrum of this fatty liver disease and is defined as steatosis with hepatocellular inflammation and ballooning degeneration of the liver cells. Fatty liver disease is defined when more than 5% of the hepatocytes, they are loaded with fat, or more than 5% of the total liver weight is due to fat. And a variety of histopathological changes, they are seen in patients with fatty liver disease. The liver cells, they are loaded with fat, mainly triglycerides, and this pattern is macro vesicular fat accumulation. There is focal necrosis of the liver cells. The liver parenchyma is infiltrated by acute and chronic inflammatory cells. There are mammary hyaline bodies. There is progressive fibrosis, and ultimately this leads to cirrhosis. And most importantly, there is no history of alcohol abuse. This entity, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, was recognized in 50s by the Zelman, but it was blissfully ignored for almost 25 years. And in 1980, Ludwig coined this term NASH for a series of 20 patients from the Mayo Clinic who presented with liver disease in the form of hepatomegaly, elevation in the liver transaminases with fat accumulations in the hepatocyte, fibrosis, and changes of advanced inflammation. And this picture was very similar to that which we see in alcoholic patients. But all these 20 patients, they were not taking moderate to large amounts of alcohol. Because the definition of fatty liver disease and NASH includes that patients should not be taking large amounts of alcohol, so there should be a criteria threshold to define the amount of the alcohol which should not be and we should not be taken by the patient before we make a diagnosis of fatty liver disease. So patient should not be a heavy alcohol drinker, and by definition the heavy drinker is one who drinks less than 20 grams per day for male and less than 10 grams for female. One average drink of alcohol is 10 grams. So patient should not be taking more than 2 alcohol drinks daily for male and not more than 1 alcohol drink daily for the female. And in terms of the individual alcoholic drinks, this 1 drink or 10 gram of the alcohol or ethanol means it is one can of beer, 4 ounces, 120 cc of the wine, or 1.5 ounce of the one shot of distilled spirit. But recently, this definition of heavy alcohol intake has been slightly modified, and now we take the amount less than 21 drinks per week for male and less than 14 drinks for female per week as the amount of heavy alcohol intake. As far as the prevalence and epidemiology of fatty liver disease is concerned, it is probably the most common liver disease in the world, and it is the main cause of chronic liver disease in many parts of the world. About 10 to 40% of the world population in different regions is considered to be suffering from fatty liver disease, and in some regions of the world the prevalence may be slightly low and it may range between 10 to 24%. Mostly we see these patients in the 4th and 6th decade of their life, and it is more common in females. There is strong association of this fatty liver disease with metabolic syndrome. The insulin resistance is the main underlying cause for development of fatty liver disease, and same insulin resistance is also responsible for the manifestation of metabolic syndrome. So it is not surprising, because of the same common mechanisms, we have a very strong association of the fatty liver disease with metabolic syndrome. And metabolic syndrome, which is also known as insulin resistance syndrome, syndrome X, or even syndrome, is basically coexistence of 5 abnormalities. And if out of these 5 abnormalities patient has more 3 or more than 3, then we make a diagnosis of metabolic syndrome. And these 5 abnormalities include obesity, which is measured in the term of waist circumference, and waist circumference of more than 102 cm for males and more than 88 cm for females. So any waist circumference which is more than 40 inches for male and more than 35 inches for female is one criteria for metabolic syndrome. Second criteria is hypertension. The third criteria is impaired glucose tolerance, or patient is frank diabetic, non-diabetic. And two abnormalities, they relate to the lipid profile. The triglyceride level should be more than 150 mg per deciliter. And the last fifth criteria is the level of HDL. They should be less than 50 mg per deciliter for females and less than 40 mg deciliter for males. So out of these 5 criteria, if patient has got 3, then we make a diagnosis of metabolic syndrome. And interestingly, all the components of the metabolic syndrome, they are independently associated with the development of fatty liver disease and NASH. And particularly, there is strong association with diabetes, with obesity, and with hypertriglyceridemia. As far as the association of fatty liver disease with obesity is concerned, steatosis has been reported in about 70% of the obese patients and 35% of the lean patients. And NASH is seen in about 18.5% of obese and 2.7% of the lean patients in different consecutive studies. And one interesting feature and important feature is progression of NASH to cirrhosis. And in 10% of the cases, the NASH can progress over the course of 10 years to chronic hepatitis and then to cirrhosis. It is basically a progression over decades. In 10 years' time, the patients of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, about 10%, they will progress to steatohepatitis, and 10% of these patients of steatohepatitis over the next 10 years will progress to cirrhosis, and about 10% of the cirrhotic patients over the course of next 10 years can develop various complications associated with cirrhosis, particularly hepatocellular carcinoma. The most of the time, the hepatocellular carcinoma occurs on background of cirrhosis in patients with NASH, but sometimes you can have this hepatocellular carcinoma occurring independent of cirrhosis, just like hepatitis B. In Pakistan, we have limited data, but different studies they suggest that prevalence of fatty liver disease is around 9% to 32% in general population. And there is high prevalence in those patients who are overweight, or they are frankly obese, and those who are pre-diabetic or have well-established diabetes. Different clinical pathological studies, they have shown that this NAFLD is a very important cause of unexplained elevation in the liver enzymes, transaminases. In different studies, it has been found to be associated with 40 to 50% cases of cryptogenic cirrhosis, where we are not able to find any demonstrable cause for the end-stage liver disease. And similarly, the cryptogenic hepatocellular carcinoma in majority of patients may also be associated with NASH and fatty liver disease. There is high prevalence of insulin resistance, and nearly half of our patients with NAFLD, they have evidence of full-blown metabolic syndrome. So again, that correlation of metabolic syndrome with the fatty liver disease and NASH is very strongly associated in Pakistani population. The fatty liver disease, NASH, is basically a histopathological diagnosis. And we see a very wide range of histopathological abnormalities, which can range from simple bland steatosis, and this is usually associated with a benign prognosis. Next stage is association of this fat with liver inflammation and ballooning degenerations, when we categorize is NASH. And this has the potential to further progress to marked fibrosis, and in about 6 to 10% of the cases can end up with cirrhosis. And the cirrhosis can have all its inherent complications of liver failure and development of hepatocellular carcinoma. The main risk factors for the development of fatty liver disease are the various components of metabolic syndrome, particularly obesity, type 2 diabetes, and dyslipidemias, and metabolic syndrome as a whole, and other cardiovascular risk factors. These are the main risk factors for the development of fatty liver disease. Recently, some other conditions, they have shown an emerging association with the fatty liver disease, and they include the polycystic ovarian syndrome, hypothyroidism, hyperpituitarism, hypogonadism, obstructive sleep apnea, and pancreatic duodenal resection. So number of conditions may be associated with fatty liver disease and NASH. And this is the diagram which shows the natural history of patients of fatty liver disease. The simple fat accumulation, when more than 5% of the hepatocytes they are loaded with fat, or more than 5% of the liver weight is due to fat, is the definition for non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. This non-alcoholic fatty liver disease may progress in about 20 to 30% of the cases with associated inflammation, ballooning, degeneration and fibrosis to NASH. And some of the patients, they will have simple fat accumulation and they will remain in the category of fatty liver disease. But there is exchange between the NASH and between the non-fatty liver disease. With proper treatment and properly addressing the underlying risk factors, this NASH can regress to fatty liver disease, and with proper lifestyle modification, this non-fatty liver disease, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, may also regress to normal liver histology. So it is always very important to consider the diagnosis of the fatty liver disease and NASH and to take appropriate measures for all the risk factors and lifestyle modification, because this disease is not only progressive but it is also reversible. Obviously, the patients who have simple fat accumulations, the majority of cases they are non-progressive. But patients who develop steatohepatitis, about 2/3 they will remain stable. But about 1/3 of the patients, they will show a progressive course and they will get progression of the fibrosis. And with increasing fibrosis, about 1/3 of these patients can develop cirrhosis. And once the patient gets cirrhosis, there are chances of decompensations and liver failure, and there are also chances of getting hepatocellular carcinoma. And ultimately, these patients, in about 20 to 30% of the cases, will require liver transplant. Fatty liver disease in most of the countries is perhaps the second common cause of liver transplant because of end-stage liver disease. Hepatitis C virus infection is still the leading cause of cirrhosis and liver transplant throughout the world. Coming to the pathogenesis and pathophysiology, simple, the process starts as fat accumulations. Deposit of fat leads to fatty liver, and this fatty liver then can have associated liver inflammation and the fibrosis, and progression of this fibrosis can ultimately end up with cirrhosis. The proposed pathogenesis for the fatty liver disease and for NASH was proposed by Day and James in 1998, and this is typically described as two-hit hypothesis. In the recent years, there have been slight modification and advances, and now we also include the third hit, rather multiple hits. But the basic concept in the pathogenesis of the NASH and fatty liver disease is this two-hit hypothesis. The first hit is accumulation of fat in the liver. Insulin resistance is the main factor. And the second stress is after the fat accumulation, then the oxidative stress and the role of various cytokines results in liver injury and ultimately produces the picture of NASH. The main underlying mechanism for the pathogenesis of NASH is insulin resistance. And because of this insulin resistance and inactivity of the hormone sensitive lipase, there is more release of fatty acids from the visceral fat and fat deposits. So there is excessive amount of free fatty acids are coming from the adipose tissues and also from the intestine in the form of diet. These free fatty acids, they are normally carried to the liver, and in the presence of hyperinsulinemia, which is because of insulin resistance. There is esterification of these free fatty acids and they are converted into triglycerides. And these triglycerides, then they are accumulated in the hepatocytes, and these hepatocytes, they become loaded with this fat in the form of triglyceride, and this leads to the initial picture of fatty liver disease. When more than 5% of the hepatocytes, they show accumulation of fat in a macrovascular pattern. So this first hit is basically the accumulation of triglyceride because of excessive release of the triglycerides from the adipose tissue as a result of insulin resistance and inactivity of the enzyme hormone sensitive lipase. This fat in the hepatocyte then produces the second hit. The availability of large amounts of fatty acids and plus the high levels of the insulin, this is the normal process when these lipids, they are mainly converted into triglycerides and they get accumulated in the liver. In the second hit, this excessive level of free fatty acids in the presence of high level of insulin, there is more oxidation of these fatty acids and there is more release of the hydroxy radicals, and these hydroxy radicals then cause injury to the liver cells. Moreover, there is also release of lipopolysaccharides from the portal veins and they result in the excessive production of the tumor necrosis factor alpha, and this results in release of various cytokines. So these two mechanisms, the oxidative stress due to excessive peroxidation of the fatty acids with the production of the free radicals, and secondly due to the excessive production of tumor necrosis factor alpha and the excessive production of the various cytokines, and these two mechanisms, they further aggravate the liver injury. And this persistent liver injury and chronic irritation of the liver cells, it also results in stimulation of the hepatic stellate cells, which are the main source of fibrosis. So this two-hit mechanism is mainly the explanation for the pathogenesis of fatty liver disease and NASH. And then this excessive level of the free radicals and plus the high level of various cytokines, they interfere with the mitochondrial functions of the liver cells. And with disturbance of these mitochondrial functions, there is disturbance with the electron transport chain, there is depletion of the adenosine triphosphatase, and there is depletion of various normal oxidative substances like glutathione. So this further aggravates the process of liver injury, and this is the concept of third hit. So first hit is the simple fat accumulation. The second hit is in the form of the oxidative stress and the role of various cytokines. And the third hit is the dysfunction of the hepatic mitochondrial functions. So when we go to the histopathological changes, the main feature which are present in all or most of the cases, they include fat accumulation in the form of large droplets, and this pattern is known as macrovascular steatosis. Then there is parenchymal inflammation, where the parenchyma is infiltrated with acute and chronic inflammatory cells. This results in necrosis of the hepatocytes, and then there is ballooning degradation of the hepatocytes. So these are the health bad features of histopathology in a patient with NASH and fatty liver disease. And this is the typical picture where you have the infiltration of the inflammatory cells. These large empty cells, they are basically the hepatocytes, which are loaded with the fats, and there is element of fibrosis and ballooning degeneration. And there are some features which are absorbed in not all patients, but with varying frequencies, and they include perivenular, perisinusoidal, or periportal fibrosis. You can have a picture of cirrhosis, where there is simultaneous evidence of necrosis, fibrosis, and nodular degenerations. Some of the cells, they can show the presence of these Mallory Hoyland bodies. There may be glycogenated nuclei, and there may be lipogranulomas and staminable hepatic iron. So these are various histopathological changes which are seen in patients of fatty liver disease and NASH. Most of the patients, they are asymptomatic, and in very few patients there may be uncommon symptoms in the form of pain or discomfort in the right upper quadrant, mild fatigue and malaise. Most of the time there may be no signs, there may be some element of hepatomegaly, and if the patient has progressed to the cirrhosis, then you can see the features associated with cirrhosis, like splenomegaly, the spider angiomas, parenchymas, ascites, and other stigmata of advanced liver disease or cirrhosis. The laboratory features, the most common is the elevation in the level of liver transaminases. And mainly this is the ALT which is elevated as compared to the AST. And the ALT and AST ratio is usually more than one. But once the patient has got advanced fibrosis and cirrhosis, then AST ratio may be more than ALT. But remember, the ALT elevation is not seen in all the patients. 20-30% of the patients, they may have normal ALT levels. And moreover, there is no direct correlation of the degree of elevations with underlying fibrosis or histopathological changes. Alkaline phosphatase may be slightly elevated in 1/3 of the patients, but because there is no element of cholestasis, so these enzymes, they are usually normal. Serum bilirubin and serum albumin and prothrombin time, most of the time they are normal, and there may be elevated level of serum ferritin. And this is a very simple algorithm how these patients, they should be approached to make a diagnosis. So most of the time you have unexplained elevation of liver enzymes or hepatomegaly, which is detected on routine clinical or lab investigation. And once you have these two abnormalities, you have to rule out the other common and possible causes of elevated liver enzyme and hepatomegaly. Remember, fatty liver disease and NASH is a diagnosis of exclusion. So you have to rule out our common causes of liver disease before you make a diagnosis of NASH. So we have to rule out the excessive use of alcohol, and especially in our part of the world, we have to rule out the viral causes as the possible cause for elevated liver enzymes and hepatomegaly. So we carry out the relevant lab investigations and we go for imaging studies in the form of ultrasound, non-contrast CT scan or MRI. And if these tests, they are normal, then we will go for liver biopsy to confirm the diagnosis of NASH and fatty liver disease. And if these imaging studies, ultrasound, most of the cases are CT scan and MRI, they show the presence of fatty liver, and then we consider the liver biopsy only in patients who are at high risk. And the high risk patients are those who have features of metabolic syndrome, they have very high levels of transaminases, their age is more than 60 years. So these are the patients who are at risk of progression of the liver disease. So then we think about the biopsy, but most of the time biopsy is not needed and we can take the same information from non-invasive investigations. So commonly the NAFLD is diagnosed incidentally because majority of the patients, they are asymptomatic. In history and physical examinations, about one third of the patients, they will have normal examinations with no abnormalities. Sometimes you can have mild hepatomegaly, but most of the time there are no clinical features to favor the diagnosis of fatty liver disease. And the diagnosis of NAFLD then requires the demonstration of fat accumulation in the liver, either by the imaging techniques or by the histology. Moreover, there should be no significant alcohol consumptions. And as we discussed earlier, the amount of alcohol should be less than 2 average drinks for males and 1 average drink for females. There should be no other competing etiologies for hepatic steatosis, and especially the chronic viral hepatitis and especially hepatitis C should always be considered as a possible cause. There should also be no coexistence causes for chronic liver disease, metabolic causes, toxic causes and other factors. And as I said, it is diagnosis first exclusion, so there should be no significant alcohol consumptions. There should be no hepatitis C, medication should not be there, and other possible associations like parenteral nutrition, Wilson disease and severe malnutrition should also be ruled out. And this is the list of the possible associations of the fatty liver disease with various clinical conditions and various drugs which may be associated with steatosis. So common alternative causes of liver steatosis, they include alcoholic liver disease, hepatitis C, especially its genotype 3, then various inborn defects of metabolism, exposure to various industrial toxins and petrochemicals. There is also association with inflammatory bowel disease, with lipodystrophy, and similarly bacterial overgrowth, total parental nutrition and starvations, they should also have a possible associations. And various surgical procedures, especially the small intestine bypass surgery, is very commonly associated with fatty liver disease. Reye syndrome is a condition where the children who are suffering from some viral infections, they are given normal or high doses of aspirin and then they develop acute fulminant liver failure and fatty accumulation in the liver, and this picture is the picture of Reye syndrome. And similarly you can have the fatty liver associated with pregnancy, and sometimes you can have this HELLP syndrome, and the HELLP stands for hemolysis, elevated liver enzymes and low platelet. H is for hemolysis, the EL is for elevated liver enzymes, and the last two words LP, they are for the low platelets. So this is commonly seen in pregnancy and especially in association with eclampsia or preeclampsia. the biochemical tests, they mainly include the liver functions in the form of serum bilirubin, the levels of transaminases, gamma GT, serum albumin, globulin, and similarly the fasting sugar levels and fasting lipoprofile levels should also be carried out, because there is strong association with diabetes or with impaired fasting glucose or with hyperlipidemias and dyslipidemias. The hematological tests, they include the complete blood count, and particularly we should be looking for platelet, because low platelet is a very common feature of portal hypertension, and this will indicate the increased amount of fibrosis and advanced degree of liver disease. And serological and immunological tests, they include the test for hepatitis C virus and for hepatitis B virus, and they are essential, especially in our part of the world, for the workup of any patient of NAFLD. So these viral tests, they should be always ruled out before we go to the diagnosis of fatty liver disease. The other markers of fibrosis which have been evaluated in different studies, they include high sensitivity C-reactive proteins, these plasma pentraxin levels, the levels of interleukin 6, and particularly this marker, these cytokeratin 8 and 18. And they are the product of apoptosis. When there is programmed cell death, these marker cytokeratin 8 and 18, they are elevated in the blood. So this test is helpful to differentiate between simple non-fatty liver disease and NASH. So patient with NASH, they will have elevated level of cytokeratin, but patient with simple fatty liver disease, they will have normal level. But still, these tests and markers, they are experimental and they are not available commercially. And liver biopsy should also be considered in those situations where the diagnosis is uncertain, the other associated liver disease cannot be ruled out, or patient is at high risk of progression of fibrosis. And these high risk are the patients who have the association with metabolic syndrome, they have very high levels of ALT and AST, they are elderly person and their age is more than 60 years. The ultrasound abdomen, this is usually the most common and the first investigations, which is very helpful in establishing the diagnosis of fatty liver disease. And with ultrasound, we compare the echogenicity of the liver with the echogenicity of the surrounding structures, the kidney and spleen. And these patients, they show hyperergenic liver as compared to these surrounding structures. Plus, we also assess the vascular blooding and deep attenuation. And these three changes, they help in grading the severity of fatty liver disease on ultrasound. Grade 1, which is mild, there is normal visualization of the diaphragm and intrahepatic vessels. With moderate, there is impaired visualization of these two structures. And with grade 3, or very severe fatty liver disease, there is very poor visualization of the diaphragm and the intrahepatic vessels. The sensitivity of the ultrasound in making a diagnosis of fatty liver disease is very variable, and this may vary from 60% to 94%, and this also varies with the amount of the fibrosis and steatosis. With more severe fibrosis and more severe steatosis, the sensitivity of the ultrasound to make diagnosis of fatty liver significantly decreases. Moreover, there are also personal limitations, and it depends from the person to person, and there are also the operator dependent observation variations. So the assessment and finding may vary from one radiologist to the other. Another limitation is that it does not provide any quantitative information of the degree of lipid accumulations. It will just show the accumulation of fat, and moreover, we cannot differentiate between the simple fatty liver and the NASH on the basis of this ultrasound examination. Non-contrast CT scan is another very useful test, but when we compare it with the ultrasound, it may have a very similar or slightly increased sensitivity and specificity, but at the same time there is also risk of radiations and the cost becomes very high. So most of the time this test, this CT scan, is not performed. The most sensitive test is MRI. This is very accurate and very rapid assessment of the liver steatosis, and this can detect very small amount of fat accumulation, less than 3%. With all other tests, you need high accumulation of fat before you make a diagnosis. But again, this test is quite expensive and is not readily available. So most of the time, out of these three imaging studies, we mainly rely on ultrasound for making diagnosis of fatty liver disease. And recently, another advancement of the MRI in the form of magnetic resonance spectroscopy, and this provides a very sensitive, quantitative and non-invasive method to measure the hepatic triglyceride content. So with this, we can also have a quantitative estimation of the amount of fat in the liver. There is more and more emphasis on the non-invasive techniques to measure the amount of fibrosis and the fat accumulations. And the two techniques which are now very commonly used as a non-invasive techniques, they include the elastography with ultrasound, which is known as FibroScan, or this shear wave elastography with MRI. So this MR equivalent of transient elastography, this has recently demonstrated very excellent diagnostic accuracy and sensitivity, and it has got very high sensitivity and specificity in the range of 98% and 99%. And this ultrasound technique of using shear wave elastography is FibroScan, and this is a non-invasive method of assessing the liver fibrosis. And this is a very simple technique. This can be performed at the bedside of the diagnosis and in the outpatient clinic. And what is the underlying technique and mechanism? This machine uses basically a probe which is kept on the right lower chest wall over the right lobe of the liver, and this probe sends shear waves to the liver, and this passage of these shear waves through the liver detects the stiffness of the liver. The more stiffness, the more transmission of these waves. So the data which is automatically processed and liver stiffness is displayed on the screen in the form of kilopascals. And the normal range is 2.5 kilopascals to 75 kilopascals. So maximum it can go up to 75 kilopascals. And the more is the fibrosis, more will be the kilopascals. What about the normal values? In 90 to 95% of the healthy patients, the result of the FibroScan will be in the range of 5.5 to 1.6 kilopascals. So around about 6 kilopascals is the normal value in most of the healthy persons. And males, they have slightly higher figure as compared to the females. And the cutoff value, they differ for different causes of cirrhosis. So different types of cirrhosis, they will have different levels of these kilopascals. And one very important thing, the results of this FibroScan, the value we get in kilopascals, they can be converted to metaverse staging of the liver biopsy by using scoring card. So this is important. The metaverse score, which was initially developed to assess the underlying histopathological abnormality in patients with hepatitis C. And the MetaVAS stands for meta-analysis to assess the histological data in viral hepatitis. So MET is for meta and VIR is for virus. This is basically was developed for chronic hepatitis C. And this is how you convert these kilopascals to the MetaVAS scoring for different types of liver diseases. And this is the simple detail of the MetaVAS grading system. We have the grade when we assess the degree of liver inflammation or the histological activity. And then we have stage, which is the stage of fibrosis. The fibrosis stage is from 0 to 5. And the stage 4 is when you have full-blown picture of liver cirrhosis. And the grading is from A0 to A3. The liver biopsy is a gold standard because you can only demonstrate the presence of the fat by direct visualization and staining on the biopsy specimen. But most of the time the biopsy is not needed, is not recommended, because of the data can be obtained with non-SF techniques, and there are also side effects associated with liver biopsy. There is definitely some degree of morbidity and some element of mortality, and sometime the specimen may not be adequate. So the histopathological assessment, it includes to establish the grade of histological activity and staging of fibrosis. And then there are different systems of assessing the severity and classifying the histological abnormalities. The traditional system was one which was proposed by Mattioni, but recently we have the further advancement in the system, and now the latest system used for histopathological assessment is one which is proposed by the Brunt. Then we have various types of scoring systems which are based on the clinical and the lab parameters, and this is the basic scoring system known as NAFLD scoring system, and this is based on these 3-4 parameters: the steatosis, the lobular inflammation, the hepatocyte ballooning and degenerations. So these 3 parameters, they are used, and we assess the score for these 3 parameters. And score of 0 to 2, they are not diagnostic of NASH, so they will rule out the NASH. Stage and score of 3 to 4, borderline. And any score which is more than 4 and score between 5 to 8, they are diagnostic of NASH. And this is the online scoring system. The apps are available. Simply you have to add your data. And there are total 6 parameters which have to be added: the age of the patients, the BMI, and whether patient has got diabetes or impaired glucose fasting, then the ratio of AST and ALT, the number of platelets and albumin. So these 6 parameters, they are added, and then we calculate the score. There is a complex way of calculating the score, but computer is doing for you, and how to make a diagnosis on the basis of scoring system. If the score is minus 1.455, this indicates that there is either no fibrosis, F0, or it is F1 or F2. and if the score is more than 0.675, this indicates advanced fibrosis F3 and 4, and the score between these two figures is in the intermediate range. So you calculate score by these parameters and then you make diagnosis about the underlying degree of fibrosis and staging of the liver disease. And coming to the treatment, the specific treatment can only be applied to the treatment of underlying risk factors. Similarly, the associated conditions and comorbidities, they should also be properly treated, and the focus is on insulin resistance, proper control of diabetes, and control of the dyslipidemias. And then if the patient presents with various complications, then we have to treat these complications, and they will include the complication associated with cirrhosis, the portal hypertension, and the hepatocellular carcinoma. Although we have now much advanced understanding about the pathophysiology and pathogenesis of the NASH and NAFLD, but still we have no approved drug for the treatment of this entity. But remember, there is no approved drug for this diagnosis. So mainstay of treatment is the lifestyle intervention. And the main emphasis is on weight reduction. For the control of steatosis, you should be reducing at least 5% of the total body weight. So minimum requirement is that patient should be losing 5% of the weight. And for most of the guidelines, the recommended target is to lose between 7 to 10% of the body weight. And this will significantly affect the amount of the steatosis, the fat, and there may also be reversal of the underlying process of fibrosis. And two main components of this lifestyle modification, they include the restriction of calories, and second one is the exercise. So calorie restrictions means you have to reduce 500 to 1000 kilocalories per day. For losing 1 pound of the weight, you require 8000 kilocalories. So it is not very easy to lose weight. Most of the time, you don't need to make very significant changes in the diet. You may limit the intake of the fats, oils, and particularly there should be restriction to the intake of fructose, because fructose, it contributes significantly to the progression and to the development of the fatty liver disease. And similarly, the second component of this lifestyle modification is the physical activity, and minimum 60 minutes of mild to moderate physical activity for at least 3 days of week, and this may be progressively increased to 5 or 6 days a week. And as far as the pharmacological treatment is concerned, still there is no agent which is FDA approved or approved by the European Medical Agency. And only two drugs, they are mainly considered. Number of treatment modalities, they have been tried, because it is very commonly associated with insulin resistance and type 2 diabetes. So insulin sensitizers like biguanides and thiazolidine diamine derivatives, they have been tried. But most of the trials, they have shown that there is no significant improvement with the use of metformin. There is some promise with the use of the pioglitazone, which is one of the thalidone, which is this thalidones and derivatives, and but the long-term use of this drug, it may be associated with the cardiovascular adverse events. It is associated with fluid accumulation and can result in congestive heart failure, and there are possible associations with the bladder cancer and with the bone loss. And one of the drug of this group, thiazolidine 1 derivatives, the rosiglitazone, was withdrawn from the market because of the cardiovascular toxicity. But later on, it was again reintroduced with slight precautions. So there are some trials of some benefit with pioglitazone. The second drug which has shown some promise is the vitamin E, because the depletion of the normal antioxidants, especially the glutathione, it is associated in the possible pathogenesis of the fatty liver disease. So the use of various antioxidant and particularly the vitamin E, it has been shown to significantly decrease the level of these transaminases. And the daily dose is 800 milligram international unit daily. But again, there are some possible risk factors associated with long-term use of vitamin E, especially it can be associated with hemorrhagic stroke. There are some trials using ursodeoxycholic acid, and there are also some trials using betaine, which is one of the amino acid. It is a methyl donor, and this to some extent can increase the level of the S-adenosylmethionine, which is one of the main antioxidant factors in the liver cells, and its depletion is considered to be associated. But again, there are no significant results with these different modalities. They have been tried in different trials, but still their exact value in the benefit of underlying fatty liver disease is still controversial. Similarly, there are some trials with omega minus 3 fatty acid, but again there is no histopathological benefit. Most of the patients of the fatty liver disease, they are put on statins. There was controversy for recommendation of statins because the statins themselves, they are associated with elevation of liver enzymes. And already these patients have elevated liver enzymes, so it was considered that the addition of statins to these patients will further aggravate their level of transaminases. But the recent studies, they have shown that it is safe to use statin in these patients with fatty liver disease, and if the patient has evidence of hyperlipidemias and high levels of the triglycerides and cholesterol, they may be treated with statins. And once the patient of NASH has progressed to the cirrhosis, then the main follow-up is for two things. Number one is worsening of this cirrhosis and worsening of portal hypertension with chances of getting into liver failure. And number two is the possible risk of developing the hepatocellular carcinoma. So every 3 months or 6 months screening with ultrasound, with CT scan and alpha fetoprotein, and periodic assessment for varices is the main follow-up for patient of NASH associated with cirrhosis. And once these patients, they have evidence of portal hypertension, they should be treated in the same way. And the primary prophylaxis is by using the non-selective beta blockers, either propranolol, nadolol, or the combined alpha and beta blocker, carvedilol. And if the patient has very high level of obesity, then one can consider the possibility of bariatric surgery. But this should only be carried out in patients who are not cirrhotic. If they are cirrhotic, it should be well compensated cirrhosis, because there is high mortality of these operations if it is carried out in the presence of liver cirrhosis. So definite benefits of bariatric surgery, but it should be carried out with precaution in patient with NASH and associated cirrhosis. And last, this is the whole summary of our today's presentation, how to proceed when you suspect a patient of NAFLD. And this is, thank you very much.